The threat of nuclear waste, next on Enviro Close Up. Welcome to Enviro Close Up. I am Carl Grossman with Kevin Kamps. He's the radioactive waste specialist of the organization Beyond Nuclear, and he's been deeply involved in battling the push by the Trump administration and the nuclear industry to dump nuclear waste in Texas and New Mexico. Welcome, Kevin. Now, what is going on?
Well, you know, for a generation now, the nuclear power establishment and industry and government has tried to dump their wastes on Western Shoshone Indian land at Yucca Mountain, Nevada, and they have not gotten away with it. There's been too much resistance. So there's a plan B that they're working on, and it's very near term. It's called Consolidated Interim Storage Facilities. They used to call it Monitored Retrievable Storage Sites. They've tried this in the past. They've never gotten away with it. Pitched battles that lasted years. The current targets for consolidated interim storage are Holtec International in New Mexico and Waste Control Specialists in Texas. And the two sites are only 39 miles apart. So what they're trying to do is turn this area on either side of the New Mexico-Texas state line into a nuclear sacrifice area for the whole country. And they've got a huge cheerleader in Trump's energy secretary, Rick Perry. When Rick Perry was governor of Texas, when he ran for president as a Republican, including in 2016, his top campaign contributor was a Dallas billionaire named Harold Simmons, the king of Superfund sites. And one of Harold Simmons' businesses was waste control specialists in Texas. So Perry, for many years now, has been a supporter of a national low-level radioactive waste dump, which is well underway at Waste Control Specialists Texas. And he's also a huge supporter of bringing in high-level radioactive waste. They call it interim storage, which means temporary. That's a lie. So last spring, in a House hearing, Rick Perry was asked a question. Would you support permanent storage at Waste Control Specialists for the high level? And he said, yes, he's fine with it. The people of Andrews County are fine with it. We should do that. That's fine. What's incredible about that, for one thing, is there's huge resistance at the grassroots in Andrews County, Texas, and neighboring communities, which are predominantly Hispanic. So again, it's an environmental justice issue. But it flies in the face of the Department of Energy's own warnings that if high-level radioactive waste remains at the surface of the planet for a long enough period of time into the future, with loss of institutional controls, it is going to leak out of its containers. And this would be a radioactive catastrophe that now is on the winds and on the waters and poisoning people. So it's incredible that he's taken this position, and I'm glad that that is out in the open, because any notion that this is temporary is false. It would become a de facto permanent surface storage site that would eventually leak.
Now, Beyond Nuclear and other organizations have been involved in litigation and other efforts to stop this. How are you doing?
We are up to our eyeballs in this fight in both New Mexico and Texas. So Beyond Nuclear has great legal counsel, Diane Curran of Washington, D.C., Mindy Goldstein of Atlanta, Georgia, and we have a single legal challenge, and it is that these proposals are illegal. The Nuclear Waste Policy Act, the law of the land on these matters that dates back to 1982, it's been amended several times since, says that the Department of Energy cannot take ownership, cannot take title, cannot take on the liability for commercial high-level radioactive waste, irradiated nuclear fuel, at an interim facility. It's not allowed. And there's a lot of wisdom behind that decision by Congress, you know, decades ago. It's because of this risk that interim temporary will become permanent, and that cannot happen at the surface. So Congress said you can't take ownership at an interim site. The only place you can take ownership is at a permanent deep geologic disposal repository, which we do not have, which the Department of Energy has admitted recently cannot happen until 2048 at the earliest, decades from now. So incredibly, these companies, Holtec International in New Mexico, Waste Control Specialists, now called Interim Storage Partners in Texas, They've just done an end run around that legal prohibition. And what's most incredible of all is the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, which presides over these licensing proceedings, has allowed them to do that. So that's beyond nuclear's legal argument. We have to exhaust all administrative remedies, which means we have to see these licensing proceedings conclude at the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. As soon as they do, we are straight to federal court. We even have the paperwork turned in already at the DC Circuit Court of Appeals, the second highest court in the land. We would like to end these licensing proceedings as soon as possible because they are illegal on their face. So that's our legal strategy. We have a broad coalition of allies, grassroots environmental groups, national environmental groups, that are taking on the million and other reasons that these dumps are bad ideas, from the transportation risks to the geological flaws of the sites proposed. I mean, for one thing, both sites are in the Permian Basin. This is the most active oil and natural gas field in North America, if you can believe that, more than the Canadian tar sands. They want to put high-level radioactive waste in the middle of the most active fossil fuel extraction industry in this country. There's an oil company called Fasken Oil, which is strange bedfellows. They are right there with us in these NRC licensing proceedings, and I hope that they will appeal to the federal courts because the writing is on the wall. NRC is going to rubber stamp both dump sites. And then we have nationwide grassroots coalition. A lot of those groups, because of the transportation impacts, the roads, the rails, the waterways through their areas of the country, be it New York, be it California, be it the Great Lakes, these proposals will see tens of thousands of shipments of high-level radioactive waste flowing by truck, by train, by barge, through most states in the lower 48, through 100-plus major cities, major urban centers, through the vast majority of U.S. congressional districts. This is everybody's problem. The same can be said of the Yucca Mountain dump, which we continue to have to fight to this day. The transportation makes this everybody's problem.
What can just people, viewers out there, do to help your case?
Well, New Mexico is a great example. There is a groundswell of opposition to this proposal. And partly what that has resulted in is not only a blue wave that happened in New Mexico in the last elections. Now there's a Democratic governor, two Democratic senators, three Democratic House members at the federal level, and also Democratic state legislature, Democratic public lands commissioner. And guess what that results in? That results in the governor, Michelle Lujan Grisham, in June saying Holtec is a bad idea. It results in the public lands commissioner, Stephanie Garcia, saying this is a bad idea, and Deb Holland, one of the first Native Americans ever elected to Congress, coming out and saying this is a bad idea. And a part of that mix is this groundswell of opposition to Holtec. There's many other issues going on in New Mexico, but that's the kind of change that can be won when people get involved. The fight is not over in New Mexico, but at least we have a fighting chance now, because the Republican candidate for governor, who was very pro-Holtec, lost his election. And that is a model that can be deployed in Texas, can be deployed. We're facing another radioactive waste threat besides what we've talked about. It's called Deep Isolation Incorporated. It's a deep borehole technology. It's related to fracking. What they want to do, and you know, truth be told, they want to do on-site disposal of the high-level radioactive wastes wherever they can get away with it. We made a clamor in the Great Lakes, where I'm very active, and they said, oh, we didn't mean the Great Lakes. Yes, they did mean the Great Lakes, but they met our clamor, and they decided it was not the path of least resistance. So recently this year, they did a test drill in Texas, which I think indicates that they're interested to set up shop as close to the consolidated interim storage as possible, so that instead of consolidated interim storage eventually exporting to the Yucca dump, which will never happen. Nevada, the Western Shoshone, and 1,000 environmental groups across this country will not let the Yucca dump happen. So here now you have a combination of consolidated interim storage in Texas, New Mexico, and this company, Deep Isolation, proposing deep borehole disposal nearby. So we have all these fights going on. That's in the US. On the Canadian side, there's this imaginary line through the Great Lakes, Canada to the north, US to the south. There is insanity being proposed on the Canadian side. They want to do what they call a deep geologic repository on the shoreline of Lake Michigan, within a mile of the water at the largest nuclear power plant on the planet. It's called Bruce Nuclear Generating Station. 9 reactors on one site, no cooling towers, dumping all that waste heat into Lake Huron. They now want to bury all the low and intermediate level radioactive waste of Ontario, 20 reactors on that site. And truth be told, they would like to bring the high level waste in, if not in the same dump, at a nearby dump. This is Saugeen Ojibwe Nation territory. This is indigenous people's land, the environmental injustice of it. So we have so many fights with radioactive waste going on.
When people hear the word radioactive waste, I mean, the waste is the important word. I mean, I think a lot of people think it's kind of like ashes from a fire. It's waste. But in fact, when nuclear material is put into a reactor, it's mildly radioactive, very mildly radioactive. But there's a process when you split the atom of fission which causes horrible poisons, terrible poisons to be created. Poisons, some of them be around millions of years and more. That's what radioactive waste is, not ashes from some nuclear process. Can you explain this process of from mildly radioactive to hotly radioactive, and it's going to be here for eternity?
Well, uranium in nature is already a toxic heavy metal and radioactive. And actually, some of the progeny from uranium in the decay chain are intensely radioactive and highly hazardous. These are natural radioactive elements, things like polonium-210. So for example, Putin used polonium-210, which exists in nature. It comes off of uranium as a decay product. Concentrated polonium-210 was used to assassinate the Russian dissident Litvinenko in London in 2006. It's a hazardous poison. It's intensely radioactive. So that's in nature. But what the nuclear power industry does is it takes uranium out of the earth, where at least the earth was some buffer against these hazards. It refines it, it concentrates it, and that's bad enough, the natural uranium or even the uranium that's been processed. But like you said, once uranium as a fuel is irradiated and a chain reaction takes place and atoms are split in an atomic reactor, it comes out a million times more radioactive. And you've also created artificial radioactive isotopes that nature has no idea what to do with, like our bodies have no idea what to do with plutonium. These are ultra hazardous substances, cesium-137, strontium-90, iodine-131, plutonium-239. These are artificial radioactive isotopes that do not exist in nature. They are generated in atomic reactors. They are constituents, the long-lasting stuff. I mean, iodine-131 was a culprit at Chernobyl, at Fukushima, caused a lot of health damage, but it only has an 8-day half-life, 80 days of hazard, and then it dissipates. But cesium-137 has a 30-year half-life, 300 years of hazard. Strontium-90, about the same as cesium. Plutonium-239 has a 24,000-year half-life. That's 240,000 years of hazard. And there's other stuff in there. We won a major lawsuit in 2004 against the Yucca Mountain dump proposal that was instrumental in slowing it down so that Obama could get elected and cancel it in 2010. And our victory was that the powers that be, the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, they wanted to cut off regulations at Yucca Mountain after just 10,000 years. No more regulations. Whatever comes out, that's the way it is. Well, like I just said, some of these poisons last a lot longer than 10,000 years. And we convinced the court of that. They ordered EPA back to the drawing board. It took EPA 4 years to rewrite its regulations, but when they came back, they admitted a million years of hazard associated with high-level radioactive waste at Yucca Mountain. That's starting to get somewhere. But there is one constituent, iodine-129, in high-level radioactive waste that has a 15-million-year half-life, 150 million years of hazard. So even that lowball 1 million years of hazard is a great underestimate of the potency of these poisons and their longevity.
In terms of these poisons, this is a book I wrote originally in 1980 after the, 79 was the Three Mile Island accident. And I sat down and I began doing research. In fact, the book is full of facsimiles of statements in often government documents. I use a lot of them, and industry in fact, if listeners, if viewers would like to get a copy of this book for free, just go on my website. You get the latest edition. You can download it for free, zero. Just go to carlgrossman.com. And, well, the publishers are being very generous, and the latest edition, post-Fukushima edition, of Cover Up What You're Not Supposed to Know About Nuclear Power is available for free. And I point this out because this is the more recent editions where I was able to use the testimony of Admiral Hyman Rickover when he retired from the Navy in 1982. And Rickover is considered the father of the nuclear navy of the United States. And also, he was in charge of the construction of the first civilian nuclear power plant in the U.S. shipping port in Pennsylvania. But somehow, 1982, Rickover saw the light. Must have been some sort of epiphany. And here he is, and again, this is page 285 of the book. Get a copy, download a copy. And I just quote Rickover's testimony before the Joint Economic Committee of Congress. And he says, I'll be philosophical. Until about 2 billion years ago, it was impossible to have any life on Earth. There was so much radiation on Earth, you couldn't have any life, fish or anything. But gradually, the amount of radiation on this planet reduced, made it possible for some form of life to begin. And that amount of radiation has been decreasing because all radiation has a half-life, which means ultimately there'll be no radiation. But now he goes on, when we use nuclear power, we are creating something which nature tried to destroy to make life possible. Every time you produce radiation, a horrible force is unleashed. And I think there the human race is going to wreck itself. And what he's speaking about are these highly toxic, these unbelievably toxic poisons that are created in the nuclear process. And then he goes on that what he thinks we have to do is to, and again, I'm quoting Rickover, not Beyond Nuclear or Greenpeace. We must outlaw nuclear reactors. Outlaw nuclear reactors. To me, that's the bottom line, that these poisons, this nuclear waste, is kills life, destroys life. It really is the same sort of poisons that existed before life could begin on Earth. And its recreation in our time, it's Rickover, will destroy life unless we outlaw nuclear reactors, and he goes on, outlaw nuclear power.
High-level radioactive waste is a curse on all future generations. So we have to isolate it from the environment, like I said, with plutonium for 240,000 years, as long as we've been a species, essentially. Iodine-129 for 150 million years, way longer than we've been a species, unimaginable forever time frames. How do you isolate this from the environment for that long? It will get out. It will get into people's food and water and air. There are also acute hazards. Those are the long-term hazards, breathing in a speck of plutonium-239 or ingesting iodine-129. But in the near term, in the first 1,000 years of the existence of high-level radioactive waste, you have to worry about the gamma and neutron radiation that's streaming off. What that means is there has to be radiation shielding between the high-level radioactive waste and any living beings for that first 1,000 years, or the neutron and gamma radiation will kill a person at a close enough distance within seconds or minutes, depending on how long it's been out of the reactor core. And so those kind of risks are what we're dealing with. So when they propose to move this stuff through the south side of Chicago, the west side of Chicago, and something goes wrong, there's a severe accident, there's a terrorist attack, and this stuff is unleashed into people's neighborhoods, that's where you get radiation poisoning deaths, like happened to the firefighters and the plant personnel at Chernobyl. But besides those immediate deaths or those near-term deaths, you have the exposure to low-dose radiation that will result in cancers over years or decades, that will result in genetic damage that then the human race carries forward into the future, that will result in birth defects to any fetus in the womb that's exposed to these hazards. Those are the risks involved with high-level radioactive waste. So there's very high stakes. There's no margin for error. An issue that gets very little play that's very significant is the shortcuts on safety being taken at the nuclear power plants where the waste is right now. So when it comes out of the reactor, it first goes into a giant pool of water. They're called wet pools. They're called high-level radioactive waste storage pools. And it's been well documented for a long time now that you could lose the cooling water in a pool. It could happen suddenly, like with a drain down, or it can happen more slowly over days or weeks, a boil down of that water. Once this irradiated nuclear fuel is exposed to air, it's quickly going to overheat within an hour or so, and then it will catch fire. The zirconium metal cladding will reach its ignition temperature, and once that happens, it's all over. It would be an order of magnitude or orders of magnitude worse than a reactor meltdown because the pools are not in radiological containment. They're in warehouse buildings. This almost happened at Fukushima Daiichi, Unit 4. It did not happen there because of sheer luck. And if it had happened there, instead of 160,000 nuclear evacuees, there could have been as many as 50 million. And it's not me saying this. It's the Prime Minister of Japan, Naoto Kan, who served during the first months of the Fukushima catastrophe, who admitted on the first anniversary in early 2012, he had a secret contingency plan in the works. If Unit 4's pool had caught fire, they were planning to evacuate 35 to 50 million people from northeastern Japan. And he said it would have been the end of the Japanese state. Those are the pool risks that we live with in the United States on a daily basis, only nobody knows about it. The Nuclear Regulatory Commission is allowing this to happen as we speak.
In terms of, in my book, I also write about zirconium. I interview a scientist for Westinghouse, in fact, and he describes how they looked for cladding, something that would allow the neutrons to fly around in a reactor. And they looked at this metal and that metal, and they finally decided on zirconium. And the only other major industrial use of zirconium at the time was the speck on a flash bulb that explodes. That was zirconium, and at a certain point, and not that hot a temperature, it explodes. Before that, it releases hydrogen gas. That's the reason for the hydrogen bubble in the Three Mile Island nuclear plant accident scenario, with the hydrogen that was emitted out of the Fukushima nuclear power plants. So you have these nuclear fuel pools, these waste pools, with these used fuel rods, but the fuel rods are coated with this hotly, extremely dangerous substance, zirconium. An example, though, I'd like to talk about this too, of how ridiculous the nuclear industry and our government is in regards to nuclear technology, is that, again, we're hearing talk of hormesis. The nuclear industry has tried to claim that actually radioactivity is good for you. It's healthy. It exercises the immune system. And in recent times, the Trump administration has began pushing hormesis as a theory, too, that radioactivity is good for you. What do you think about that?
It's mad science. It's quackery. They play a lot of games with the truth in the nuclear power industry. I've thought of that during the Trump era, that, you know, it seems so unprecedented, President Trump, and the assault on basic facts and knowledge and the truth on a daily, hourly basis. And it occurred to me at one point that actually we've been dealing with this for a long time, fighting the nuclear power industry. They play these games themselves in their own arena, their own industry. Hormesis is an example of that, where they try to convince people that ionizing radioactivity that causes cancer, that causes birth defects, that causes genetic damage can somehow be good for you. It's absurd. It's preposterous. But they have to, because they have to calm people down about these risks. We've been talking about catastrophes, disasters, accidents, terrorist attacks. What about the daily operation of atomic reactors? There are routine releases of radioactivity into air and water that then enters the food chain, reconcentrates, and humans are at the top of the food chain eating and drinking these reconcentrated radioactivity doses if they live close enough to nuclear power plants, which are allowed, permitted by the Nuclear Regulatory Commission to emit radioactivity as a course of normal business. An incredible quote from Fukushima, for example, in the earliest days before they realized how serious the world was taking this catastrophe that was unfolding, was a Tokyo Electric Power Company spokesman who said, "Why are you getting so upset about these releases into the ocean from this accident? We would release 10% this amount normally, anyway, running the reactors." It was a very revealing statement that they try not to make because they do let a lot of radioactivity go on a normal day at a nuclear power plant. There's a small reactor in Michigan that shut down in 1997, Big Rock Point. I compiled their admitted releases that they reported to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, to air, to water. They released 3.2 million curies of radioactivity into the environment over the course of their operations, and that didn't even include the first few years of operations because they didn't keep good records back then. Those would have been the worst years, by the way. By comparison, a major medical institution like Washington University in St. Louis, which has a research hospital, has two curies of radioactivity in the entire hospital that they very carefully control because it's dangerous. Two curies at this little atomic reactor, 67 megawatts up in northern Michigan, 1/15th the size of a modern reactor. They let go of 3.2 million curies of harmful radioactivity into the environment and didn't account for where it went. They like you to believe that it disappears into nothingness. It does not disappear into nothingness. People breathe it, people eat it. It actually reconcentrates in the food chain. It's called bioaccumulation. To give you an example, at Big Rock Point, after they shut down, they had radioactive algae wash back up the discharge canal from Lake Michigan and set off the radiation alarms. This is 6 months after closure. The radioactive algae set off the radiation alarms. So what was their response? To dismantle the radiation alarms. They don't want people to know.
Yeah, that's why I titled the book, Cover Up What You're Not Supposed to Know About Nuclear Power. I begin it. You've not been informed about nuclear power. You haven't been told. That's been done on purpose. Keeping the public in the dark was deemed necessary by the promoters of nuclear power if it was to succeed in the cover-up. Sorry to say, continues. Kevin Kamps breaks through that cover-up and fights this monstrous activity. Thanks so much for your work, Kevin Kamps. This has been Enviro Close-Up. I'm Carl Grossman. Thank you for watching. And check out the other programs of Enviro Video on our website, envirovideo.com.